So, guten Abend, Leute. Es freut mich, heute hier zu sein, aber ich kann kein Deutsch reden. Du verstehst es nicht allen und ich spreche es keine ganze Stunde, so ich gehe weiter in Englisch. So, I'm from Netherlands and I work for an international company which is located amongst others in the Netherlands. It's called Mendix. And what we do is we built an application studio which is used by large companies, accountant, consulting companies like Capgemini to build software. So if you ever feel for relocating to the Netherlands, then visit us. We were just recently chosen as a best tech employer in the Netherlands. So just that you know, this is the end of the sponsored message. You can see the slides of this presentation on that URL if you want to browse back during my talk or something. So what will I be thinking about? So 1.5 years ago, I published a library called Mobix. It's a reactive programming library, just as RxJS is, but with a completely different application area. And so I first will be talking about what the mental model is behind Mobix. And after that, I will talk about a bit about the basics, not too much. But because I have some time, I will visit some recipes, how you can approach several problems in front-end development, like routing and async stuff and forms with this mental model in your head. Then there, my hour is fully over. So then it's time for Q&A, and if it isn't over, then I will talk about how Mobix is different or similar from other things you know. And otherwise, if you cannot figure a question, then you can ask for that. And I didn't prepare it for nothing. So I'm messing with the system here. So first part, thinking in derivations. So we all know what the most complex problems are in programming, right? It's guess invalidation, and it's naming things. So I won't be talking about these. I will talk about even more complex problems. So how can we solve really, really complex problems with Mobix? And what are really complex problems? Well, the Dutch tax system. It's super complicated. I'll show you in a minute why. Also, merits. It's also super complicated. That's what it makes it interesting. So this is the Dutch tax system summarized. And it has three boxes. I probably cannot read the rest of it because it's in Dutch. But don't worry, the Department of Taxes in the Netherlands has actually translated their site to both English and German. So that's great. So let's go to the translation. And the translation reads like this. And it basically says, well, there are three boxes which you have to report your taxes. And there are, for each box, there is a rate. We don't tell you what the rate is, but it's the same rate as applied to the Dutch residents. And if you want to find out, well, see the Dutch description of the rates. So, in short, it says, don't put money in the wrong box, otherwise all your money are belong to us. So, as you can imagine, it's super complicated. We don't even want to translate it. Applications, and all code you write for applications, you can also categorize them into three boxes. And that's what we will do tonight. So here are three boxes. Skeptical people will say these are four boxes, but actually, those are three boxes. So the first box is the data your application is about. What data is stored in your application? The fourth box in which you can categorize code, the fourth of the three boxes, is how you, where you change your data. So your application has data. It has objects or fields which store data for you, but you will also have code that changes this data. And then there's also data that can be computed from the data you already have. Most applications have a lot of data which could be derived from the base data you have. This can be things like lookup tables where customers are sorted by some ID or by name. You only need to have the base data to derive these new pieces of information from. You can even say that helps for the complete UI. You can derive what your DOM should look like if you know just the data which is stored in your application. The DOM is just a derivation. And then in the end, we also need some freaking side effects to achieve something. In the end, we always need to flush something to the DOM, or we have to make network requests. And these are things you can only express with side effects. They don't produce values, they produce effects. So why is this model with the three boxes so important? Well, I think this is basically the same pattern as which is used in the most successful software product ever, spreadsheets. And why is that product so successful, in my opinion? That's because everybody can reason with it. You don't have to have studied computer science to be able to work with something like Excel. I mean, this basically rules the world, despite all the software engineering practices we have developed over the years. And a spreadsheet basically follows the same model. So you have a state. It's basically the values you store in your spreadsheet. So these are the data cells. Then there are actions happening in the spreadsheet. That is when the user enters new values in one of the data cells. Because what happens if you enter new data, then the formulas get updated. And formulas, they just transform existing data in some new piece of data. And what in this analogy would be a side effect is actually drawing that information on your screen so that you can see it. If you wouldn't draw it on the screen or something, you wouldn't even have to bother to compute it because you wouldn't store it. You don't store the values, you just store the formulas. So it's the fact that you draw it on the screen that makes it actually necessary to calculate. So in this model, we're gonna do a small exercise. So I've encoded my own wife into some data object. And her first name is Elise, and her girl's name is Hagendoorn. And so what her current full name is, which are on letters, well, that depends. On what does it depend? On the fact whether she has a husband or not. And actually, there are very complicated rules for this, turns out, but we keep it simple. So we could imagine that we write some function that sets the husband of this woman. So we take women and we take a husband and we assign the husband to the women, pretty straightforward. But then we also update her full name. Because her full name is now, if she's married, it's different, because it now depends on the name of the husband. Okay, it's a super contrived example, but well. So, in this marriage, what could possibly go wrong? I mean, this could look pretty straightforward, right? So, getting broke. I think that would be handled correctly here. We could have fights, and that could turn out to become a divorce, and then said husband would be called with husband null, but it will still be all handled correctly. But what goes wrong is if the husband decides to change his last name. Because what happens then Elise would still have the old last name of the husband. So suddenly we would have a data inconsistency. And this is a very unlikely scenario to happen, but it has happened actually to some people. I mean, people do sometimes change their last name. You just don't ever think about it. So, how could we have fixed this marriage? So first of all, the most simple solution is that, well, the wife could keep using her own last name. All problem solved. In practice, I can recommend it. It's way easier for any tax forms you fill out. But despite that, we could make sure that the name is always derived. That the last name is never actually stored. It's just derived on either the original, from either the original family name or the name of the husband. Still following this super contrived example? So in plain JavaScript, we could have it expressed it as a getter property, where every time we want to know the full name of Elise, we just calculate it from the fact whether she has a husband or not. And if you express it this way, you just have to update the husband and the full name will always be correct. So that is why it's important to don't store redundant data in your application, because as soon as you store redundant information, you might introduce update or stillness bugs. So back to the model, the family name, that's of Elise, that's actually a piece of, that's actually a fact. So that is a box one thing. The husband she's married to, that's also a fact. But the contrary, her last name she's currently using is a derived value, it's a formula. Assigning a new husband, that's an instance of modifying an existing fact, updating or introducing a new fact. And me going to cry in the corner, if that husband is changed, that's a side effect of the fact that a new husband is assigned. So again, we have the three awesome boxes here. So, and that is basically the conceptual model behind the WMIX library. And make sure that whenever you have data, it's always automatically, whenever you have data and you have derived values and side effects that depends on your data, that they are always updated or always triggered whenever relevant data is changed, regardless when you change it or how you change it. So basically, it makes that your whole application works similar to a spreadsheet. There's some data and everything is derived from that. So in the MobX terminology, we call that box one, we call that observable values. So pieces of information. And modifying data, that's what we call an action. And then we also have computed values. So that is producing a new value based on the existing values we have. And we have reaction, that is producing a side effect based on the values we have. So box two and three are very similar. They both observe data and respond to it. The difference is that box three produces a new value, and box three produces a side effect. An interesting thing is that you don't have to compute new values if that value is not used in some side effect anywhere. So if you can put something in box two, that's awesome, because you can often optimize it away if you don't need it anymore. So in the MobX API, the core of it boils down to those same four concepts. You have observable, which makes existing data observable. So the MobX can track what's happening to this data. You can introduce computed values, and you can introduce actions which modify data. And there are reactions. There are several flavors of them, but these are all forms of triggering some side effect if data changes. And I'll show you some examples later on. And by the way, this weird, how do you call it? Monkey tail. Do you call it in English that way? I don't know. Sorry? Oh, it's, of course. Those stand for decorators in the ES Next proposal, but those are optional to use, but it makes it synthetically very nice. So here we have the same piece of data, and I have now two objects. One is Elise, and I turn it into observable by using observable. And here's me, and I'm a bit more, I'm simple. So I only have two fields. And actually here I have the same code. So I have two observable pieces of data. And then I also have two side effects. And one side effect is, well, track whether Elise is still married to me. And if that is the case, then I'm happy. And if it changes, then I'm sad. And so we don't tell when this should run or when it should be updated. We just tell this is the relation between the fact and the side effect. And also there's another side effect that's, that prints the full name of Elise so that whenever that changes, we get to see what her name is. So if we run that, we have created now one object. And now I simply tell, so basically I'm now performing an action, Elise's husband, that's Michel. So it will now automatically, make sure I figured out that some side effects need to be triggered. So first of all, Elise has now has a new name. And secondly, I am happy. So and if I now update my name, his name. Elise's name is also updated. I didn't tell system to do that, but it knows that because it's derived from that fact. And so if I unassign husband, then she has her original name back and I'm crying in the corner. But what it shows is that Bix does the tracking for us. It has remembered at which point, so to show that I can change my last name again. And now nothing happens with Elise because that relationship isn't there anymore. SmallBix knows that this fact now doesn't relate any more to the last name of Elise, so let's skip it. Oh, that's annoying. So, another exercise. Let's suppose that we have an application that has to-dos, super original, and there's multi-selection going on. So we have a class to-do, and to-do has a title and a selection property, and also the to-do store has a collection of to-dos and a collection of to-do stores. So the question of this is, which pieces of information are facts, and which pieces of information are derived values? So one solution would be this, is we say that, well, the to-dos, which to-dos exist, that's a fact. And whether a certain to-do is selected, that's also a fact. But then the collection of selected to-dos, that should be a piece of derived information. Because if we consider that as a fact as well, then we can have two facts which are out of sync with each other. Then we're introducing redundant data. Because then we could end up theoretically in a situation where this collection doesn't match all the to-dos which are actually selected. So you could actually write it in MLBix as the selected to-dos as with a typo, so this won't work, but you get the idea. The selected to-dos is basically the filter of all the to-dos which are selected. And now these pieces of information can never be out of sync. We could also have done it the other way around. We could have said, well, the collection of selected to-dos, that's a fact. And then the property whether a to-do is selected, that can be derived from whether it's in that set of selected to-dos. It doesn't matter that much. My preference would go to the first, but It's really up to you, but the important thing is that you should try to find the minimum. Okay, do we have sound again? Cool. So I hope this gets the basic thinking a bit more clear of Mobix. So let's go apply this way of thinking to some scenarios we would be dealing with in normal situations. I mean, most applications are not about divorces or Dutch tax systems. So let's talk about forms. So here we have a very simple form in which you can enter passwords. So it looks like this. Does it work? So you can enter two passwords. You cannot press the next button because there are still validation errors. So I could type something. Now it's long enough, but not equal. And now everything's valid, so I could press next. Etc. Pretty basic stuff. But how does this look if you think in observable state and derived information? So we have a small React component, and it's decorated with observer, and it basically is the only thing you need to make a React component Mobix aware, and it basically means track whatever information is relevant for rendering, and render again whenever relevant information changes. And so there are two facts in this small form, and that are the two passwords that are entered. And so we have two input fields in the rendering, and whenever one of them changes, the corresponding field is updated based on the event. So this is pretty straightforward. Note that we don't tell here that the component should re-render, because it might very well be that this password is not actually relevant for the rendering. Maybe we don't show it anywhere, and then the component shouldn't re-render. That's something for Mobix to figure out. We just say, hey, here's a small action, update this password with the given value. So from those two passwords, we could derive several facts. For example, we could derive whether those passwords are equal, and we could derive whether they are long enough. And from those two facts, in turn, we could derive a validation message, which is shown to the user. And so what we then render is also the validation message, the current state, and we disable the button as long as there is a validation message. So, and from there, Mobix basically does all the things it needs, and it will render automatically because the validation message changed, etc. So that's all optimized away for you. So this is a very simple example of a form, but validations fit very nicely in the idea of deriving information from some facts you actually have. And you might have noticed this, that we didn't use React set state. For those who are familiar with
React,
which is the built-in mechanism to manage state. And you can still use set state with MobX, but most people using MobX don't do that, or don't do that very often. And the reason for that is that observables are much better optimized than React's own set state is. So if you call set state in React, it will always trigger a re-render, whether something relevant for the rendering has changed or not. Maybe you have some piece of information which is sometimes interesting for the rendering, and in some other cases not. For example, if it's part of some condition. And React won't figure that out for you, but MobX will figure that out. And also, if you just stick to using observables, you can very easily, if it becomes more complex, factor out those observables to a separate object, separate class, so that you have better separation of concerns. And I also blogged about that, so you can check it out. And it's pretty easy to write your own form library on top of these mechanisms. A few good ones exist. There are a lot more of them. But that's basically because it is so easy to write forms in MobX. So another pattern, async stuff. It's always a hot item in the JavaScript world. But in this model of, in this thinking model, it's actually pretty simple to think about it, because an async process is just a synchronous process at least two different points in time. Especially in JavaScript, this is true because it's single-threaded. So something happens on point A in time, and something happens on point B in time. But these separate processes are no different from normal synchronous processes. So the only thing you have to do for async processes is track their progress. You can perfectly use observables for that if you want to communicate something back to the user. So actually, there's nothing special about it. So here's an example of an asynchronous process. And what basically what we have here is a collection of users. And we have also, we tracked how many outstanding network requests we have. So that as long as there's more than zero network requests going on, we know that we're still in some loading state. So if we then have an action that requests users, we just increase the number of request counts so that we can communicate it with the user. And we make the network request, and after it completes, we add the users to the new collection, reduce the network request count. And basically, that's it. But you can clearly see there's just two actions going on. The outer one here, which increases the request number and kicks off the process. And in here, there's a second action, which is executed in some future point in time. But because our application is derived from the data we have, even future actions will probably propagate their changes to the UI. So let's show that. Here's the same application. Somehow, GSFiddle has messed up the indentation. But as you can see, we just simply map over the user and render them. And we have a button that calls the request user method. So over here. So if you click it, it says loading, and you can click it multiple times. And it keeps adding users. So it's pretty straightforward, as you see. Just think about it as two actions, two different points of time, because both actions in the end will cause a re-render, because their data is, they modify, is relevant for the UI. And actually, this pattern of fetching data and then updating some flag that the request has finished is quite common. So MobX also provides a utility that, given a promise, which we create here, creates an observable data structure from that promise. And that data structure basically looks like this. It has some observable fields. One is the state in which the promise currently is, and one, if it is resolved, what its value is. And that makes this pattern of fetching data and tracking the progress of fetching the data even shorter. And it also has a very convenient case method in which you can pass separate handlers for either of the states. So here we have almost the same application, except that it now uses from promise. And each time we request users, it doesn't append the list, but it replaces the current data set. And so what the nice thing is that if you then render it, this rendering will automatically re-trigger as every time it transitions to the next state. So now it has loaded a set, and now it loads a second set, and a third one. And I can also press it very quickly. And now I know for sure that always the last requested set is the winner, so to speak, because that is the promise we are looking at in the user's property. So each time I press the button, a new promise gets stored in the users, and that is the one which is causing the rendering. So let's zoom out a bit and take a look at how we can organize state. So far we only have seen component state actually, or we only use component state. So state which is actually allowed to be lost if you reload the application or something. But there's also the really important state in your application, which is relevant for most of your application. It's your domain state, what it is about. And you can store that in your components if you want, but that's often not what you want, because it's having all your logic in your components makes it hard to reuse, to build SDKs from it, to test it. Then you cannot approach a problem without thinking or rendering components. So often the real domain state is something you want to have decoupled from your UI. You might have different application based on the same domain state, but with completely different purpose. So the hard thing with MobX is it doesn't tell you how you should organize your domain state. It's quite unopinionated about it. So you could use classes, which I did so far in my examples, but you could also use just plain JavaScript objects. You could use an object graph where all data is just connected to other pieces of data via direct pointers, or you could just store references as string. And you can put the methods with your classes, or you can have them a separate action somewhere. MobX doesn't tell you really anything about that. So the architecture is open. But still, there are some good tips. And also, if you're going to dive into this, check those two packages. Serializer is really nice if you go for classes, because then you have to think about serialization. And MobX State Tree is currently a work in progress, but it's a very opinionated state container which puts all data in a tree and have some benefits based on that. So here's an example of a very simple domain model, a to-do item, again, super original. It has a title and then a done field. And when we create it, we probably provide some JSON, which we got from our server. And then we just update our fields based on this JSON. So this is what a simple model class could look like with MobX. And then we can also give it some actions like toggle your done status or delete this to-do. And then you probably want to communicate with the collection that stores this to-do hey, please remove this one. And of course, you also have, at some point, have to serialize your to-do again if you want to send it to a server or store it in local storage or do with it whatever. And the interesting thing is that JSON, just like your UI, is just a piece of information that can be derived from the actual facts you have. So it's just another computed value. So we could simply introduce a computed value that returns the JSON representation of this very object. And what you can then do with that representation is you can set up a side effect that whenever this representation changes, send it to the server. So that means that if you change one of the fields of the to-do, that will affect the JSON representation, and that will make sure that the side effect is triggered storing your changes on the server. So here we just react to the JSON representation and send it to the server. And could similarly have classes that store our collections of to-dos or whatever is relevant to your application and define actions on them. If you want to check out some real life examples, there are some pretty cool OpenBix projects which are public. Of course, you can imagine that in larger applications, at some point you will have many stores, one for to-dos, one for users, for whatever. And then at some point you will have to communicate between stores. A to-do might relate to a user, and there's some relations going on there. So what people often ask is, how do you organize multiple stores? How do you let them know about each other? And there are several patterns you can follow. One is you could use singletons and just import them and then ask questions from them. I usually don't use that because it makes it hard to test them, because then you have to reset your singletons to some zero state. You can also use a dependency injection system, something like InversifyJS. I'm also not really a fan of dependency injection systems myself, because they tend to be get quite complicated and hard to get strongly typed or to debug. So the pattern we usually follow is having a root store. And a root store is a kind of one-for-all, all-for-one mechanism. It's just a store that stores all other stores. And nice thing is that with such a store, we can avoid global state, which makes especially testing a lot easier. So how does it look like? Our root store, or our root app state, can have two other stores, a to-do store and a user store. And it can also contain some environment-specific things, like the fetch implementation, which in the browser is window.fetch, but in your unit test, it might be some mocked service. And so when we create a new root store, is that root store instantiates all other stores, passes itself, and then you have a quite simple pattern where you can always reach out to other stores through the root store. And what I especially like about this is that it stays strongly typed. So if you're using TypeScript or Flow, then you have proper analysis about what you are accessing. And this is then how you could use it in testing. You could just create a new root store, and we pass it our own implementation of fetch, which always returns the same data in this case. And then we can make assertions on this root store. And because it's short-lived, we can just throw it away, and in the next test, we use a new root store. And in the client, of course, you only have to instantiate one. We give it a real fetch implementation, and then we pass that into our component tree. So it's basically a scalable pattern to organize many stores and connect them together. You just saw provider inject. Those are, for those who are familiar with React, how many people are familiar with React? Yeah, so there's the magic concept of context in React, where you can have a piece of information in one component, and then you want to skip several levels of components, and then have it very deep in component tree available at some other component. But it has some drawbacks. And one of the most notorious thing is that using context often breaks if you combine it with manual written React optimizations like should component update. Especially Redux plus React Router was in the past notorious for this. So Mobix provides its own provider and inject mechanism that leverages context but which doesn't run into those problems. And so what it roughly looked like is that at the root, in the root of your component tree, you want to pass some piece of information, like the color of our application is a red. That's our current team. And then in between, there are just some other components rendered, like messages. And somewhere deep inside the message, there's a button rendered. But the rendering of that button depends on the color of our team. So at that point, we can inject the color property, which has been provided earlier, and we have it available in this component. So if you have to inject data somewhere at root and have it deeply available, check out provider inject. It's a pattern we quite often use for things like internationalization or teaming, those kind of things. So we always have this idea, especially in React land, that the UI should be some quite dumb thing. It's, there's this mantra in the React world, the view is just a function of your state. And the idea is that the less logic lives in your component, the easier your components are to test, but also the easier your application is to test without needing to mount components or something, so that you can test your logic completely separately from your components. And that makes both your components portable to other applications and the logic and the data models you have. So what I however often see happening in applications, and which we run into ourselves, is that in practice we don't really decouple these components as nicely as we could. So for example, what happens when you use something like React Router is that React Router creates a component tree based on the match route, and then it instantiates some components, and they have components that mount hooks, and they start interpreting the path parameters, etc., and start updating the state based on the current route. So what you see is that we mount a component, and as a side effect of mounting that component, we immediately start changing the state. So what in fact happens is that we say that the UI is a function of our state, but in fact you could almost say that the opposite happens. We first mount some components, and then our state becomes a function of what happens in those components. So to really mimic our application flow, we have to execute all those component did mount and other lifecycle hooks. So actually, in that paradigm, we are coupling our components very strongly to the logic we have. So in the ideal situation, what should happen is that if a URL changes, based on the change, the state is updated, and based on that, the components are re-rendered. Then they are truly only a function of the state. But if the state update depends on the components being mounted first, we break this pattern. So to do that, we could start capturing our application state in observables. So you could have some simple view store which, for example, say which is the currently logged in user and what is the current view we are looking at. And so then we could, at least programmatically, move to a different view by creating simple functions that update the current view. For example, you could create a view that's called overview, and it needs some documents which are fetched from the server. And of course, this could also be parameterized if you want to open a specific document. So then we have captured our state of our application without having actually components. So all the state is now outside the components. And we could already at this point test our application flow. So we could instantiate such a view store, call that show overview function. And you know, at that point, the current view name should be overview. And if we inspect the docs, then at some point in the future, the doc state should no longer be pending because the promise has resolved. And if it has resolved, then its state should be fulfilled and there should be two documents. So, and you could have many functions like show overview that express all the possible states your application can be in. And still, we don't have any coupling with components yet. So, and then we can do the rendering based on the state. It becomes really straightforward. We just inspect the current view, and based on the current view, we render the correct component. So at this point, you don't need component hooks anymore to fetch our data, for example. We don't rely on our components hooks to trigger this fetching. We rely on our actions that update the state to do this fetching. So it becomes truly universal. But of course, we also need to do things which are related to routing, like updating the URL. But then again, the URL is just a piece of derived information. If you know what application state your application is in this moment of time, you know what URL should be. So we could just introduce a computed property that, given the current state, returns the correct URL. And then every time that URL changes, we just push it onto the history using the history API. So we have a derived information and a side effect that updates the URL, just like it updates the DOM. And the last final piece is that you also have to take care of the inverse process, that if the URL changes, for example, because the user presses forward or back, then you have to make sure that the state is updated. So that can be done by using a very simple router, like a director, or just listen to the history API yourself. It's pretty straightforward. And whenever there's a change of URL, we just make sure that we trigger the corresponding action, which updates the state. So instead of mounting components because URL changes, we now update the state because the URL changes. And as a result, new components get mounted. So the flow becomes a lot more simple. So actually, we arrived at this image. So there are two possible actions, roughly speaking. The user can do something like clicking a field or a button, and then it updates the state, and then it updates components because they are derived from the state, and also it updates the URL you are seeing, because that's also a side effect of changing state. But changing the URL or going back or forth follows the same paradigm. It's just a user that triggers an action that updates the state, and based on that, we update the components and the location information. So in our original box mental model, we have still the state which is in the center of everything, which determines what's happening in our application. And we have derived information, and we have actions that update the state. So with this pattern, I think the important thing is that you can capture all the crucial app information in a store. It is not even aware of the fact that you're running in a browser. So it makes it very straightforward to test or to do stuff server-side or even use it with a completely different UI framework. And funny enough, I wrote a blog post about the Spectrum a while ago, and few libraries were immediately written to implement that pattern. And one of them is OnBig Router. It's quite fancy, so it captures all the boilerplate you just saw, where you have to still set up your own listening to the browser API. And you just define a path, an action when the path is triggered, and a component that should be used to render the result, or a component that should be rendered afterwards. And it's also a also interesting is the MobX location library, which just turns the browser location into an observable and leaves the rest up to you. So it considers just location or piece of state. And if you still like React Router, there's also MobX React Router, which basically makes the same coupling as React Router Redux does. Finally, and a different thing, mostly because it's an interesting and funny example of what you can do with observables and driving state. In the MobX utils, there's a small function. It's called now, and it returns the current time, the epoch timestamp. But it considers time to be an observable, so it doesn't just return the time once, but it actually has a backing observable that updates every given interval with the new timestamp. And you can specify this timestamp, by default it's a second, but you can also say whenever there's an animation frame available, update the now time of the application. Because in the end, time is the ultimate observable. It's time, per definition, isn't something immutable. It changes and changes and changes. And so what you can then build is a very simple application that just does a countdown. And so it updates every second, telling you how long it is until the next new year. But the cool thing is that there's no set interval anywhere in this application. There's no request animation frame. The only thing that makes sure that this component gets triggered every second is the fact that there's the now timestamp requested. And this timestamp is updated every second, and for that the time left changes. And for that, the component will re-render every second. So you can also update the interval of... can we do that here? So you could also make it slower, and now we have a new interval every 2 seconds. So it's first maybe might be weird to read that now keeps returning new values, but this basically creates a stream of new timestamps. And from that, the rest of our application is derived. So that basically summarizes MobX. It's about finding the minimal set of observables that expresses the state of your application, and then derive as many things from that as possible, like making network requests, or the location of your browser, or validation messages of your form. And the nice thing is that MobX just keeps those derivations in sync with the state for you. And the advantage of that is that it becomes actually super simple to write applications, because you write them as if state never changes. And that, in turn, leads often to productivity. That's what I hear the most from people using MobX, that it's so easy or so fast to write stuff with. But also important that it eliminates a lot of bugs related to cascading updates. Such as, for example, when I updated my own last name and then didn't think of the scenario where that should have affected other data. And similar, it eliminates books to staleness. And the final advantage of that is that it's super performant, because it does all the precise tracking. It knows exactly what should be updated and what not. So if my name change is relevant for the rendering of my wife, then it will re-render my wife's component, so to speak. But if my name change isn't relevant for it, it will also not re-render the component. So we don't have to say, please re-render all, or have to make these decisions on our own. We know them all bigs, we'll pick exactly the right components to re-render. So, it's Q&A time. So for those that too long didn't listen, pay your taxes, apply MobX patterns, and then you have time left to enjoy your spouse or find one. Thanks.
So, thank you, Michel. It's time for the Q&A, I guess, right? So we use this microphone so everybody can hear who's watching the stream and the recording. So, does anybody have any questions? I wish I.
Was it so clear or so unclear?
Michelle, what's your favorite color? Let's break the
blue.
Ice.
Blue.
So anybody have a question?
They call it blue. Well, maybe I can then take a few seconds to show you what we use MobX for at Mendix. Because as said, what we actually do with MobX is building an application development studio. So what you see here is an application studio in which you can draw your own application, and you can connect it to data and data sources, and you can define the data model behind the application. A nice thing is that they're all kind of rich interactions, and they're all pieces of information which relate to each other. So for example, these arrows have coordinates, but the coordinates depend on the coordinates of the entity, because of course the arrow shouldn't be pointing into the void. But we don't have any logic in our application that makes sure that these arrows get updated. It's just because by dragging, we change the coordinates of the entity, and the fact that in the arrow components, these coordinates are used, make sure the arrow components get re-rendered at the proper time. So even if we make, for example, the entity bigger, we know for sure that you didn't forget this case of moving the entities, because MobX itself has determined that resizing the box means moving the entity to the right, the arrow. So this is what we are building with MobX. It has hundreds of thousands of observables active in memory, and we know just for sure that whenever somebody changes some data, everything which uses the data is updated. So we are working with four development teams in parallel on this project, and the only thing we communicate basically with each other is what is the data model behind this application. And we don't have to know from each other which data people are using in their rendering, because we know that if we change the data, their rendering will be updated accordingly. So we don't have to coordinate which reducers we have or APIs to update the data. We just say, in whatever way you want to update the data, we know for sure it will be consistent. So that's basically what we are doing at Mendix.
Sorry, if I'd be strange to ask you, how is MobX different from a digest cycle or a digest cycle based framework?
In MobX, there is no digest cycle. So we don't do any diffing on the data to see if it changed. Instead, when data is changed at that moment in time, it's immediately propagated to all observers. And there's other frameworks often do that, like in the next tick. So in the future, please update these things. But this leads to a lot of complex scenarios or bug-sensitive systems, because then you're always having the question, okay, I changed this piece of data, I know in the next tick everything observing my data will update accordingly, but I don't know whether that moment has already happened or not, or probably it hasn't happened yet. So MobX is quite unique from things like Meteor or Angular, which has a Digest cycle, in the sense that all observers are notified immediately. The danger of that having is that you could trigger observers in the wrong order. So if you have an observer which via two paths observes a piece of data, you could have glitches theoretically. But MobX behind the scenes does order the derivation graph. This is super abstract. but so that it does notify everyone who needs to be updated, but in the correct order, so that everybody is updated only once. So whatever piece of data I change, after that change, everything that depends on that piece of data will be updated. So it's programmatically impossible to ever observe a stale value which is derived from it, and that's quite different from existing frameworks.
Thanks, sounds crazy.
Hi, thanks for the presentation. And the question is, so compared to Redux, MobX wants us to create lots of stores, right? Is right, or maybe I'm wrong?
No, that's up to you. Because it's not really opinionated about it, how you organize your data.
Is there any rule how you decide when to create a new store or when to use the root store?
No, not really. So the only thing MobX actually does, technically speaking, is if you have some observable data, regardless of where it is, and something that uses it, make sure that usage stays in sync with the piece of data wherever it comes from. So that means that it doesn't matter for MobX whether you have many stores or that you have one store and whether it's a tree or a graph. So that's mostly up to the people using it to decide. So that's what makes it MobX both really convenient for people, because you're completely open in how you architect your state, how it is stored. But also it's hard because it doesn't tell you how to do that. So the only thing MobX really wants to force you is, if you have a piece of state, make sure it's not redundant with some other piece of state. That's the only thing which is important. And what people like about MobX is that it's really convenient to write if you have those model classes. And some people just build a graph of model classes, or some just a tree, or some keep it even denormalized, where everything is a flat list with identifiers. It's pretty much up to you.
All right, thanks.
Can derived data in MobX also be observable?
Yes, derived data is by default observable, and observable as well. It's just an observable you cannot change, it's just one direction. So for example, the validation methods in the form example, it was derived from two other computed values, namely the length check and the equal check. There's a question in the back. That's a good question. So let's go back to the beginning. So the question is, since you establish all those observers, won't you be leaking memory like crazy? And the answer is no, for several reasons. First of all, it's very cheap to establish observers because it's all in the framework. Actually, observers aren't even callbacks. It's just an array of these other atoms are observing me. So memory-wise, it's very cheap. You don't even create a closure per observer. But that could still leak, of course. But that is the reason why this third box is divided into two. So it turns out you have two kind of observers. One computed values, which produce a value, and one which produce side effects. Now the nice thing is that those computed values will establish observers relations with pieces of state. But if nobody is using this computed value, what MobX will do is that it will suspend this computed value and remove all the observer relationships until it's accessed again. So that means that those computed values can always be garbage collected as long as they are not observed themselves. So in the end, there's one place where you need to dispose something, and that is on the reaction or side effect side of things. Because from a side effect, you cannot tell when it should stop. If we have this console lock where we lock the name of Elise, we don't know when the user wants that effect to stop. So that is the only place where people have to dispose something. Let's see if I can find that code back. Yes, so this full name will observe first name and husband and husband's last name, but only if full name itself is used by this autorun method. So this autorun actually returns a disposure function, which if you invoke it, stops this effect. And because the effect is stopped, nobody uses full name, so full name will be disposed automatically as well. Because we know the value is not in use, so we know we can safely stop it. And the nice thing is that even this disposing of side effects can often be abstracted away in the framework. So if you have a React component, what the observer decorator does, it basically puts the render function of the component in an autorun, so it re-renders whenever relevant data changes. But when the component gets unmounted, it disposes that autorun. So you can have a list of data with 1,000 to-do items, which all have computed properties. But if you are only rendering 10 components, only the computed properties of those to-do items which are rendered actually are observed, and the other 900 are not actually evaluated or observing anything. So almost all your garbage collection is automated away for you. You mean for the, so the question is how do you dispose the reactions?
Yes.
Yes, so this actually returns a function, this autorun. And if you invoke that function, then that's basically the disposure function. So that stops the effect, disposing all relationships.
Okay.